Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and I am ever so excited to be in neuro with you so we can talk about the anatomy associated with neurology. We are going to start our discussions with this video on the cranial meninges, and hopefully you recall some of the details regarding the meninges, because we did discuss meninges when we discussed the spinal cord, as meninges are associated with both the spinal cord and the brain, and they are continuous with one another. And the cranial meninges, as well as the spinal meninges, will share many, many similarities, but there are a few distinct differences between the two, and we will talk about that as well. So, as a review, there are three membranous layers that surround the central nervous system. And recall that the central nervous system is composed of the spinal cord and the brain. Our focus for these upcoming learning objectives will be the brain. The major function of these layers is really to support and to protect the central nervous system. And there's going to be three main layers, from superficial to deep. There is the dura mater, which is going to be the most robust. It literally means tough mother. So when we do the craniotomy, you will see, it will be the first thing you see. It is quite opaque and very obvious. Now, there are two layers associated with the brain of the dura mater. And that's where this big difference comes between the two, as there's only one layer of dura mater associated with the spinal cord. So more to come on these two layers in some upcoming slides. And you can see, just before I move on, you can see here the two layers of the dura mater associated with the, and this is brain here. Okay, next or intermediate will be the arachnoid mater, which is much thinner than the dura and is adhered to the dura mater, but separated from the pia mater by all these spider-like trabeculae that are going to be found throughout the subarachnoid space. This is actually where the arachnoid gets its name, are these kind of spider web-like arachnoid trabeculae. Lastly, there is the pia mater, which is extremely closely related, or very intimately related, to the brain and the vasculature that is on the brain. It is transparent. It gives kind of the shiny appearance that you'll see associated with the central nervous system. Okay, let's talk a little bit more about this cranial dura and its two separate divisions, as this is unique to the cranial dura. But let's start with the basics. So there is going to be, first and foremost, the periosteal dura mater. And I'm going to kind of outline the periosteal dura mater right here. Put a P. And I know that this is the periosteal dura because right here, this handy dandy label that says bone. The periosteal, sometimes referred to as the endosteal dura, will line the cranial cavity, so it's actually adhering to the internal surfaces of the bone. There's not a space right here. With the meningeal layer, which is the deeper or more inner layer of the dura mater, this is going to be closer to the neural tissue and closely applied to the arachnoid mater. So here is going to be the meningeal dura, kind of outlining it right here. We'll talk about some of these dips in a moment. In certain areas, the meningeal layer will actually reflect inward, as you can see occurring right here, creating what's referred to as dural partitions or dural infoldings, and we will discuss this in quite a bit more detail in the next slide. Now, in other areas, so not as you can see here in this image, but in a lot of areas, that periosteal and meningeal dura will actually be very closely adhered. But in certain areas, they will separate from one another in order to allow for deoxygenated blood to flow through regions. And these regions are called the dural venous sinuses. So that's what all of this blue is right here. The superior sagittal sinus is a venous sinus. We will have a whole learning objective video regarding the dural venous sinuses, so more to come on that, I promise. But before we finish, I do want to talk a little bit more about the dural partitions. These form partial partitions or compartments throughout the cranial cavity, and they're going to be located in between specific parts of the brain. And because of this organization, it really serves to provide additional support in this area. There are actually four dural partitions, but we are going to focus on the two largest. And so starting with the fossa cerebri, which is actually the largest, I'm going to kind of outline kind of the basic area of the fossa cerebri with my very kind of wiggly line. It's going to be located in the longitudinal cerebral fissure. So it's actually in the sagittal plane between the cerebral hemispheres. So that longitudinal fissure is going to be located between the two cerebral hemispheres. The brain's been removed in this dissection, but you would have one cerebral hemisphere kind of facing you and one on the other side of the fossa cerebri. It's this very distinctive sickle shape, and it will actually house both the superior and inferior sagittal sinuses. So one of those sinuses has been open here. That's that superior sagittal sinus running right there. The second largest is going to be the tentorium cerebelli, and you can see this is the tentorium cerebelli here. It's more transverse in orientation. You'll have a similar component of it on this other side as well, on the right side. And the tentorium cerebelli will separate the cerebrum from the cerebellum. All right, so very close names, but it will separate the cerebrum from the cerebellum. So in essence, separating the forebrain from the hindbrain. It also creates this notch, which I'm going to outline here, referred to as the tentorial notch, which is the internal or anterior concave border of the tentorium cerebelli. And this is actually where the midbrain will sit. So the cerebellum would be kind of deep to the tentorium cerebelli, and the cerebrum will be more superior. In certain pathological conditions, like brain swelling or with space-occupying lesions, portions of the brain, such as, say, like the temporal lobe of the cerebrum, which is not too far away from the tentorial notch, will actually herniate into the tentorial notch. This is tentorial herniation. And what that will do is compress the contents in this region. So as we just discussed, the midbrain is going to sit in the tentorial notch, and it can affect some of the neurovascular structures associated with the midbrain, such as the oculomotor nerve, which is cranial nerve 3. The posterior cerebral artery is also going to be in that general area. So if you have that compression of these structures, that can have implications in different presentations. All right, we have reached the summary slide, which I hope will be helpful to consolidate these high-yield concepts we discussed here. Thank you for your time and attention, and please feel free to reach out with any questions. Have a great day.